Anita Morgan says, how does the body make hormones and what nutrients and foods does it need to do this? That's
such a good question.
That's I think that's a very general question. Do you want to feel that or should we?
Sure. We got asked this question in the lab because a doctor was fighting with one of my doctors as to what nutrient raises estrogen. And the doctor was just new. She was new to hormones and she'd been in a different field of medicine. And she was like, well, what nutrient can I give to raise estrogen? And it made me realize just how much people don't realize how female hormones are made, since she's female. I'll start with female. Okay. So, and most of the time when people say how are hormones made, they're thinking estrogen and progesterone when I get asked that question, yeah. Right, from a woman. So women, ladies, you have two ovaries. You should have two ovaries. You're born with two ovaries in theory, and they're surrounded by follicles. And on the follicles are cells, and inside the follicle is the egg that's going to eventually pop out. So you have initially at the start of your month, you have two types of cells. You have what's called theca cells, and that makes your testosterone. And you have your granulosa cells, and that's what makes your estradiol, your E2, right there in your ovary. So your testosterone actually aromatizes into your estrogen and your granulosa cells. And then you ovulate. So once you kick out an egg, the granulosa and the theca cells turn into lutein cells or your corpus luteum. It's the luteal phase of your cycle, the second half. And those cells make progesterone and your progesterone goes up. And then if you're not pregnant, your progesterone comes down. If you're pregnant, then your progesterone stays up until your placenta and then gradually starts to come down and your placenta makes progesterone and takes over. So, but hormones, first and foremost, as Chris said earlier, those hormones come from cholesterol. So cholesterol is the backbone to all of your hormones. They're called your steroid hormones. And cholesterol is pulled into the cell. And then it's pulled into the mitochondria. And it goes through a series of steps to eventually make the hormone that you're looking for. Testosterone, which I mentioned, estrogen, and then, of course, it makes progesterone. And so that's how it's made in a cycling woman. So then I get asked, well, where's the rest of it made? So testosterone is also made, ladies, in your adrenal glands. You make about 25-ish% in your adrenal glands. You do make some in your fat tissue as well from another hormone called androstenedione. And then as you go through menopause, and now your ovaries, the follicles in your ovaries are gone, the ovaries are closed for business, then you make the most of your estrogen out of your fat tissue. Ladies, you can take your testosterone made from your adrenal glands and your fat tissue and convert it into what's called estrone or E1. And then E1 can become the potent E2 version. So you still eke out a little estrogen in menopause. And then progesterone is actually sort of made out of the adrenal glands. We hardly make any progesterone, like near zero as we go in menopause. But the adrenal glands will release some progesterone when it's making like cortisol or, you know, some of the other hormones in menopause, but it's like micro tiny amounts. So that's, ladies, how you make estrogen, progesterone, and testosterone, which is usually what people are asking when they say, where is it made from? Now, as far as nutrients go, like I said, cholesterol is the backbone to all of your hormones. So much like the gentleman who said earlier, his cholesterol was quite low, it can impact the way and the amount of hormones that you make. The lower your cholesterol is, the tougher time you can have to make hormones. But the more cholesterol you make doesn't necessarily mean you're going to have mass amounts of hormones. It's a very tightly controlled system. But as far as like nutrients go, really it's a signaling that we're working with. Nutrients are helpful, but like, it's not like we say like, oh, this nutrient makes estrogen. There's no nutrient that you can give to create estrogen. But what we can do is we can help the brain communicate with the ovary and to get the estrogen production happening. We can do all the cellular health, like the healthy fats and, you know, the fish oils and choline and things that make your cell membranes really healthy. And so that they can, like, so they can make hormone and hormone can, you know, come out into your system. And on top of that, your hormones are transported through your blood. So if you are a smoker, if you have diabetes, if you are not very active, you don't like to exercise, you're very stagnant, then your hormones are also going to have a tough time circulating around because your circulatory system is not very good. It's not very healthy. So your hormone from your brain will have a tough time getting down to the hormone from your ovary or out of your ovary over to your skin or your heart or your lungs or wherever it needs to go. And so that's kind of like my quick snapshot for women. Where are those hormones made? Now, obviously there are other hormones, thyroid hormone, cortisol, brain hormones, but usually women mean estrogen and progesterone when they're asking me that. Men are a little different. So they don't have ovaries.
No, we have testes.
Yes.
So I'll just throw out, I have not done a comprehensive deep dive into every nutrient that's needed to make hormones, but first, there was a very interesting study done, I think it was done in the 1990s, I forget, but it was done in boys who are not undergoing puberty, and they compared vitamin A and iron to testosterone treatment and to a couple other androgen treatments. And the kids that got vitamin A and iron were like, the vitamin A and iron was just as potent and actually acted twice as fast to induce puberty as the testosterone and other androgens did. And you know, you can be pretty sure that those kids were deficient in vitamin A and iron though. And the amount that they gave wasn't a lot. But hormones dip in zinc deficiency too. Mm-hmm. I mentioned before that vitamin K can act as a signaling compound for synthesizing hormones. And vitamin D and calcium can affect the signaling to produce sex hormones too. I think if we went through and looked at all of the enzymes involved, at least iron would be involved in some as cofactor for some of those enzymes. We would probably find other things too. I don't know what they all are off the top of my head.
Yeah.
But I think there's a lot of nutrients where, you know, for one, like whatever's going to work is really going to be highly dependent on what is your missing link, right? So if someone's zinc deficient, then probably if their hormones are messed up, the thing that's going to work is you're going to replace the zinc.
Right.
But not everyone is zinc deficient. And there's a lot of people who have hormone problems that aren't fundamentally about micronutrients. For some people, it's they don't need enough food. For some people, it's they don't have enough body fat. For some people, it's they have too much body fat. For some
people, stress.
Too much food. There's stress. Right. And so many things that probably if you were deficient in almost any nutrient enough, there's going to be something messed up about your hormones.
Oh, completely.
And so it's more of a, it's more of a, an individual thing where you have to look for what's actually gone wrong in that person.
But it's not a direct, it's not like if you give this, if you give vitamin C, you're going to create cortisol out of it. Or if you, it's not how those hormones.
Yeah. You're not going to create.
You're not going to derive.
But,
yeah. But they're very supportive. Absolutely.
But you might increase the levels of something.
Correct.
So there is the effect of vitamin C on hormones is not very well studied, but
my example.
but there is a study showing, I forget the exact findings. There's a study out there showing that vitamin C supplementation increases sexual intercourse.
I don't know that I would believe that, but okay. Well, you realize all your listeners are going to go out and be like, vitamin C, please.
Well, maybe a statistician might question the study design. I don't know, but, so like vitamin C is needed for, so one of the things in the brain that controls the production of all of these hormones we've been talking about more is the production of neuropeptides that have alpha, what is it called? Alpha I forgot the name of it. It's like alpha peptidoglycine something. I don't know, but there's two enzymes that are dependent on, one's dependent on vitamin C and copper, and the other is structurally dependent on zinc. the vitamin C and copper are redox cofactors, and they're needed to activate half of the neuropeptides. And among the neuropeptides that are activated are all of the hypothalamic releasing hormones. So we usually call them hormones, but those are neuropeptides. And so if you didn't have enough vitamin C and copper in that, you know, to make the neuropeptides, that could be a reason why you'd have low TRH or GnRH, or any of the releasing hormones. And so your thyroid hormones, your sex hormones, and your adrenal hormones could all wind up getting tanked because of that. And so I guess the question is, how deficient do you need to be for those? Also oxytocin, which is needed for the pair bonding response to physical intimacy, is one of those neuropeptides that needs to be activated in that way. So it's a reasonable hypothesis that vitamin C status could impact the production of thyroid hormones, sex hormones, and adrenal hormones. And so maybe that, an oxytocin, come on, that can play a role in how often you have sex with your spouse. Come on.
For sure.
How long you hug afterwards and cuddle.
Yeah, absolutely.
So,
but oxytocin does.
Yeah. So but it still comes back to the thing, like, I feel like biological complexity is sort of like an onion. You know, you can talk about one thing like that, but then you peel back that layer and you say, well, okay, how does the copper and vitamin C get into the brain? Or like, what made the enzyme that used the vitamin C and copper to do that? You just start tracing back the layer and the layer. Eventually you're going to see that all of the vitamins, all of the minerals, the fat, the protein, and the carbohydrate, and how much you ate are all going to be things that can influence the hormone levels. And it's sort of
how you digest.
An answer a question that is that general it potentially has an answer that just says everything. And then the only way to make that more specific is to start narrowing down the case by saying, okay, in this person who has this context with this specific problem. And then at that point you might be able to say, well, it's probably a nutrient. It's probably not a nutrient. Mm-hmm. It's probably sleep. It's probably stress. It's probably whatever it might be. So a very general question can get a very general answer.
You get a very wide, varied answer.
All right. Thank you for your question, Anita.